Welcome back. I hope you enjoyed the first half of our programming for today. For those of you who are just joining us, this is the 2021 virtual conference sponsored by the Center for Black Literature, the National Black Writing Biennial Symposium. I'm Donna Hill, and I want to welcome everybody to the second half of our program. Both Paule Marshall and John A. Williams were contributors to the, and I'm going to change the word here because earlier in our conversation, Brother Ishmael Reed said, canon is very arbitrary. I think that's true. So both Paule Marshall and John A. Williams were major contributors to the breadth and the depth of African-American and Caribbean literature. In this segment of our program, Dr. Carol Boyce-Davies, the Frank H. T. Rose Professor of Humane Letters and Professor of Africana Studies and English at Cornell University, will discuss the work of Paule Marshall, and Dr. Maryemma Graham, University Distinguished Professor in English at the University of Kansas, will examine the works of John A. Williams. So I'd like to first begin with a brief introduction of Dr. Carol Boyce-Davies, and then we'll look at a short clip before her presentation. Dr. Davies is the author of the prize-winning Left of Karl Marx, The Political Life of a Black Communist Claudia Jones, 2008, The Classic Black Woman, Writing and Identity, Migrations of the Subject, 1984, Caribbean Spaces, Escape Routes from Twilight Zones, 2013, on the internalization of Caribbean culture. Her current research project is a contracted manuscript titled Alternative Presidents, Black Women and Political Leadership, 2021. She is the past president of the Caribbean Studies Association, and you can download the full bio of Dr. Boyce-Davies at the Center for Black Literature. org. And now we will take a brief look at the video, Paule Marshall, Coming of Age.
Well, of course, I had known this work all along.
Of course.
Yes. And one of the things that struck me, the big C, and I wonder as I wander, his two books about traveling, I came across in the library as a teenager, and I knew that he was the writer for me because this is exactly what I wanted to do. The big C meaning to travel, you know. I wonder as I wander. That struck me as just the most marvelous life that one could possibly have and also be a writer. You see, so he was someone that I admired from early on.
Triangular Road is yes. The name of your memoir. What are the 3 points?
The 3 points are, in a sense, what defines me. I was born in Brooklyn, New York, USA. So that is very much there. My parents came from a tiny, tiny island in the Caribbean called Barbados. That's the second link. And then I was invited some years ago to visit Africa and saw, just as I was doing research for the trip, looking at maps, saw that Barbados was the first point. This little tiny island was the first point for many of the slave ships coming from the Gold Coast. So there are the 3 points that define me.
How did it change you, having actually experienced Africa, a piece of it anyway, in person?
In person, it was, in a sense, coming home and feeling very comfortable there, but also feeling embraced. All of these people at the conference, it was a conference, a big conference held in Nigeria, in Lagos. All of these other scholars and writers from Africa and so on were coming over to tell me what part of my face belonged to them. the shape of the nose, the lips, the contour of the cheeks, and so on.
As you write, that Africa represents, quote, the greater portion of my tripartite self.
Yes.
That I had yet to discover, yet to know.
And yet to know.
Do you keep going back?
No, that what I'm going to be working on next is that further penetration into Africa to discover that self.
Where do you want to go?
I'm going to, I've touched base there once or twice. I'm going to start out in Kenya, then go down to Uganda, and as further south as I can get.
And you're right that the Atlantic is, quote, an entire ocean permanently sitting Shiva.
Yes, sitting Shiva. When you walk along the Atlantic, you can hear a kind, and as it comes in, and a powerful waves, it's as if it's tearing itself apart. And you know, the whole ritual in Shiva is the Jewish ritual of mourning, with the women, you know, sort of tear their clothes and so on. As I walked, the first time I walked along the Atlantic in Barbados, I said, this sea is sitting Shiva for the tyranny that took place.
Do you think our country is starting to come to terms with the heritage of slavery in a meaningful way?
Well, I think there's emotions. Yes, I think so. But there is so much more by way of practical acknowledgement that it still needs to be done.
Thank you. And please welcome Dr. Carol Boyce-Davies.
Hi, good afternoon. It's such a pleasure being here. I actually got very nostalgic looking at Paul Marshall and missing her deeply. Such a joy seeing her as I begin my presentation. So I thank you for that. I don't want to get teary, but I felt like that for a minute. Anyway, are you hearing me? Is it all good?
Yes, it's all good. The floor is yours.
Wonderful. Okay, so my talk today is called Exit Strategies and Circularities, Paul Marshall's Poetics of Place. Okay, Exit Strategies and Circularities, Paula Marshall's Poetics of Place. And she actually touched on it in a way in that little clip you just saw, which when the interviewer asked her what were her 3 points, right? And she gives you them in terms of her familial connection. I would like to offer in my presentation her 3 points as the Caribbean, Africa, and African America. And we can expand any of those questions or locations in different directions, as you know, but let's leave it at that for now. So on an island called Ngor, just off Dakar, I stood at the final point closest to the Americas, and can you imagine the trauma of a forced journey in that direction? It was before all the pandemic dramas and in 2018. Always, though, the possibility of connections, emotive and physical, painful and joyful, have consistently functioned as a trope, as a theme, as a structure, if you want, in African diaspora history and culture, and perhaps more deliberately as expressed by our writers and artists in general. In Caribbean Space 2013, I tried to show another angle of seeing or engaging the world. In that way, I wanted, of course, to see the Caribbean, not just in the way that it's identified often in terms of islands only, but the larger context of Caribbean space, always radiating outwards with its people, ideas, and culture, creating diasporas in several locations as well. So in the time allotted, I want to talk about Paula Marshall's Triangular Roads, one, and how she navigates her own Caribbean diaspora. In describing the poetics of place as expressed in African-American women's writing, Houston Baker in his There Is No More Beautiful Way, offers for me the best way of understanding this question of poetics of place. There he describes a mapping of position in which the successful theorist not only understands the importance of his or her autobiographical situation, but must also be able to direct attention to authentic sources of Black expressive culture. Africans uprooted via the Middle Passage then, which created the first level African diaspora, he suggests, maintain their culture at the meta level. Thus, he concludes, the most forceful expressive cultural spokespersons of Afro-America have traditionally been those who have first mastered a discourse at its most rarefied meta levels, as well as at its quotidian performative levels, and then autobiographically written themselves and their own meta levels palimpsestically on the scroll of this mastery. It's an interesting formulation. It's the mastering of a particular form and then writing oneself into that form as well. Basically then, how to take self, place, and creativity, and with these create the universal. I want to suggest this is what Paula Marshall's work does for the African diaspora. While the discourse of diaspora has become a popular academic consideration in the late 20th and into the 21st century, the histories of migration and the definitions of hemispheric American identities have been significantly linked to this question of diaspora creation. In an earlier work, I studied the actual legal implications of African diaspora citizenship in a piece titled Towards African Diaspora Citizenship, Politicizing a Pre-existing Global Geography, which was published, in case you want to look for it, in Black Geographies and the Politics of Place, edited by Catherine McKittrick and Clyde Woods, Southend Press, 2007. There, I used the precedence of actual or emotive or spiritual returns, but also linked these then as just one level of those connections, the more significant ones being the actual physical returns for different reasons, not necessarily for permanent stays, but for definitely for certain kinds of connections, the connections that Marshall just described earlier in terms of recognitions or in terms of people embracing her. Of course, I lived in Nigeria for 3 years. It's not always embracing. Sometimes people treat you just like anybody else. So like if you're in New York City and you can't expect always that people are gonna be like, ah, welcome. They'll be like, who are you, right? So the argument though for us is that those of us who live in the Americas today navigate another level of diaspora creation, and that is that Caribbean diaspora creation. And therefore tension exists in that overlap between the longer historical diaspora, keep that in mind, the first level African diaspora, and the more recent diasporas, the Caribbean diasporas and so on, created in the pre and post-independence migrations. But we also see then that whole question of the need to create new geographies, as Dionne Brand would describe it in her book, Map to the Door of No Return. But thinking with Paula Marshall, for me, as a diasporic creative theoretical exponent, I see a series of diasporic circulations and sojourns in different locations, which also typify creative Caribbean identities. Marshall demonstrates that deliberate move then is outside of fixity or being fixed, but also being aware and in practice always looking at the way these diasporas are intersecting, i.e. the overlapping diasporas of Africa and the Caribbean, but also the African-American and the Caribbean. That's what I meant about seeing her three triangular points. So one, in other words, what I'm thinking and just her imaging of that is a series of triangulations, not always, you know, operating in the same flattened way, or always identifiable in the same way, but different ways of seeing these triangulations. I think that's one of the ways I want us to keep thinking about her, right? So the assumption then carries with it a series of homes, which is suggested for the Caribbean diasporic subject. Caribbean identity then, according to Brand, has to be one which is always ready for continuous self-invention. And this in many ways is the contribution of the Caribbean, I would say, a multiplicity of discourses expressed in politics and practice. As we have shown in prior work, migration studies reveal that none of these flows of people which create diasporas are accidental, but are all related to larger forces like enslavement, which created the initial transatlantic traffic and which also created the conditions, we want to say, in the wake of the Meghan Markle drama, for the conditions of Europe and America's capitalist expansion, colonialism and neocolonialism and underdevelopment, right? Immigration legislation, the push and pull of transnational labor and migration flows, but also, as we see, intellectual, cultural, and political linkages, and a basic human desire for movement. For Marshall, then, these are triangular movements which engender circulations, which perhaps interest me more as they do not presuppose neat returns to a beginning point, but a level of engagement that accounts for a series of transnational movements of ideas, if not bodies. These, for me, are still ongoing processes. Keep that in mind. It's not over. And our artists and writers, if they are imaginatively and politically engaged, are perhaps best at understanding these imagined and real geographies that we are often denied. As they write diaspora, then, as Marshall demonstrates, they are not contained by the boundaries of the United States. This is what Marshall was contributing, the creative theoretics then of the actual possibility of movement that ruptures the colonial separations between southern geographies and the Caribbean, imagines as well the global South as within reach, and also allows a different and possible set of recrossings. I want to hold up an interview Paula Marshall did when she was in Nigeria at that exact Festac cultural encounter that she describes to the interviewer. She came to Ibadan, where I was a graduate student, and actually did an interview with Molara Ogundipe during then what would be her first and only visit to Africa. This interview is titled Recreating Ourselves All Over the World. And I want to draw a little bit from this in this discussion today for a couple of reasons. One of them is that we lost Molara Ogundipe a couple of years ago, sadly. And the second is because this interview probably hasn't gotten sufficient attention, but it's totally relevant to what we are talking about today. It's published in a book I edited with Molara titled Moving Beyond Boundaries, International Dimensions of Black Women's Writing, and also a second volume called Black Women's Diasporas, which has those three or four conversations. In there, though, from a continental vantage point, she described her work as navigating different geographies of home beyond the mythological or actual return, trying to bring about some kind of synthesis then between what is often seen as different or discrete experiences. And she does this through reworking some of the mythologies that are common to both experiences, using, for example, the flying back narratives, not the logic of necessarily flying back, but the spiritual qualities of return, the actual physical connections, the poetics and place, therefore, of the diaspora. For example, Molara tells her, quote, "You tend to compare people to masks. I thought that was very effective, using masks to describe the facial configuration of people," unquote. Paula responds, "Yes, these are the ways I'm attempting not only to make the connection between the Black experience in the Western Hemisphere and in Africa, but also to infuse the work with a new kind of imagery, a new reference." When asked about her style, though, if these are African formal renderings, she says, quote, "I think it's basically African, also in a basic way universal." And from there, she goes on to talk about storytelling as an ancient art, not specific to any culture or civilization, but really fundamental to how human beings express story. She also expresses a familiarity with Amos Tutuola in what she calls his stream and flow, with the character moving constantly through a world that is both real and unreal. The chosen place then, The Timeless People, is one of those works I want to suggest, which does precisely that. She is able to allow, in her words, witnesses then to speak to the whole history of slave enslavement and its aftermath, the kind of afterness or wake that Christina Sharp describes. So I'm going to talk then in the rest of the time about two themes then that I see running through her work. The one, of course, Paula Marshall's Triangular Roads, is quite evident that she's doing that. It comes directly from her memoir published in 2009, where I see her developing that model of the intra and extra Caribbean circulation that I want us to think about. So it describes the movement of both parents, a father who goes from Barbados to Cuba as a contract worker, but ends up back in the same cane fields he was escaping in Barbados, and decides to stow away to New York and arrives there to be now to enter factory work and distill the dissatisfied experience that he was running away from. In a way, it's interesting that his disappearance from the work doesn't pick up that aspect of the sort of failed logic of this better life that he was seeking. But clearly he enters a kind of spiritual zone of existence that Marshall herself describes in some of her other interviews. But on the other hand, there's a mother who enters the Black domestic worker community made up of African Americans who migrated from the South and a range of Caribbean and Latin American places, right? So Paula Marshall then is a product of these migrations, and as a result is able to offer us a range of those beautiful texts which engage diaspora as well as these class positions deliberately, endowing them with a certain creativity as she does in From the Poets in the Kitchen, New York Times 1983 essay. In fact, earlier discussions of Marshall, we know, could not figure out who she was. Was she, in some bibliographies, she's Caribbean, in some, she is African American. And of course, there had not been an obvious category of African diaspora writers then. So we are happy that she herself indicates that she was both and therefore solidly located as an African diaspora writer. And she says this in some of her interviews. In my reading then, she, like Olade Equiano, or even Mary Prince of the Caribbean Freedom Narratives, typifies best that African diaspora subjectivity, both in subject and in content, in that phenomenon lived experience of Blackness sense, without the pain of, or perhaps outside of, persistent racism. For Marshall, Africa and the entire African diaspora is home, as she shows in Triangular Road. But the triangulations that she indicates are both intra and extra Caribbean triangulations. In her particular case, the question of her parents and their experience. But keep in mind that she would subsequently then go from the Caribbean to Brazil and write a series of travelogues in which she encounters the African diasporic experience in the South American context. So she meets the legendary Irmandade de Boamochi and there discovers a site of African New World aesthetic mythologies and therefore that process of recreation that she titles a work, the interview she did with Mulara Ogundipe Leslie that ended up becoming the title. So while she does not go to Africa physically until Festac, 1977, she does visit Africa in the Caribbean. Those sites set up the recreation of African cosmologies in the New World. I think probably the more recent writers like Taya Selassie or Yagiasi who do Homecoming probably best also find ways of writing back to that African experience in a way that Marshall could not. So for her, the question of finding that home in the diaspora is probably more significant. She says then our legends, our myths, all of these then provide us with the way to go back to that experience. She indicates as well that in African American folklore, this notion of flying, this logic of flight always permeates. And for her, it becomes, and for me as well, it becomes an open myth used aesthetically, I would suggest, in several different creative frameworks, a kind of challenge to the available physics as is walking on water back to Africa, but also the use of imaginary that has possibility for actualization as we shall see. So the next section then, the next session is called Marshall's Caribbean Diasporas. And there what I tried to do was talk about the ways in which via Brownville Brownstone's 1959, its signature text of its generation, she really zeroes in then on that Caribbean recreation of home in a different location. Of that same generation, significantly, that would produce the first Black Congresswoman, Shirley Chisholm, who would subsequently run for President of the United States in her work On Board and Boyce, 1917. Marshall here depicts the Caribbean woman migrant in New York who jostles with Black and white Americans for resources and above all a home. What I found in common though is Chisholm's childhood memories of her grandmother with whom she lived in the years of her Barbados period, but also Marshall's similar story called To Dada in Memoriam, a deliberate evocation of the strength of that post-enslavement generation, still developing their own provision grounds, as Winter would call them, in spite of the surrounding plantation extraction processes that surrounded them. And yet, the issue of labor exploitation weighs heavily on those women, as Marshall describes, and as Claudia Jones describes it in her The Super Exploitation of the Black Woman. Excuse me, some water. The important actual documentation then from a study done in 1935 was titled The Bronx Slave Market, where white women would actually come down the street and select a domestic day laborer, slave auction style. These are precisely the women Marshall brings to life and makes poets in her own classic Poets in the Kitchen, giving them voice, the meaning about what it is to live in this quote unquote man's country as they ensure the next generation have opportunities to move forward. So in quoting her, she describes their days spent scrubbing floor as they describe their work they did. And she of course refers to them as unknown bards who would go out to Flatbush Avenue and try to find work. And of course were selected for work in which they had to do probably a week's work in a day. But then she would also talk about Bimsha in Barbados. She would also talk about that and listen to them describe this question of where they came from, this lovely Caribbean location that they remembered in difficult ways. So they discuss both, and she indicates how that they navigated those two experiences as they struggled to work for the white man's dollar, right? So there's a lot going on deceptively short creative piece. Through their eyes, we witness the women who become Caribbean domestic labor without the benefit of union support, super exploited, experiencing race as Black women do in the combinations that we still experience, but all through it, the desire to earn and above all, recreate a life in this new elsewhere, outside of the boundaries of extractive settler colonial British racism. So I've spent quite a bit of time writing about these various texts, so I won't go into detail in it. And it's probably the more popular and famous one that everybody has read, so I will probably leave it there. But when she gets to The Chosen Place, The Timeless People, she creates a Caribbean mythical island. And that also is home, as she indicates, through her character Merle, who wants to leave, wants to go to Africa with the promise of return, and says, this is home, whatever I can do, I'll always come back here as well. I was always impressed too by the fact that she has Merle go all the way from the Caribbean to Africa imaginatively without going through North America or without going through Europe. In other words, she would go to Brazil, then further south, cross over Recife and fly to the continent that way. So I know we're coming close to time, so I'll come to conclusion here. Of course, I spent a bit of time more talking about Pray Song for the Widow and how she creates that exit strategy for Avi, who is able to leave the superficiality of the cruise ship, this liminal experience, and instead find a place of immersion in Afro-Caribbean culture and its cosmologies. It presents then that text, Pray Song for the Widow, a kind of diasporic circularity, which I see as a pattern emerging in all her work. So conclusion, we call Paula Marshall a Caribbean griot as she received an award from the Caribbean American Book and Art Fair in 2006. There she joined a range of other authors who saw the African diaspora not as lack, but as gain. Caribbean identities allow us to understand definitions of identity as fluid, constructed, shaped by history as by contemporary economic and global forces, as by what happens in the nation slash home context. Even though people hold on dearly to national identities, we also know that these were definitely shaped by the creation of flags, anthems, and state apparata at the dawning of independence. These ongoing migrations consistently create new identities, new unnecessary communities. the primary diasporas carry with them the logic of forced migration and thereby the logic of an older home exile dialectic. Subsequent movement which re-diasporize or recreate the Caribbean diaspora in Marshall terms are more in keeping than, I'm suggesting Marshall is more in keeping than, with 20th and 21st century movements which are more voluntary in nature, though there's often an economic impetus behind these migrations. But both combine often the older African and Indian diaspora created through voluntary forced trade or induced migrations with the more contemporary migrations, which have produced a diasporic community of Caribbeans living in major world nations. And I want to suggest that it's not necessarily always smooth. Sometimes there's tension, sometimes there's conflict, but through it all are these two operating diasporas that are moving in different directions, sometimes that often moving in the same direction. So Paula Marshall then in 2019, we have to suggest was anticipate, sorry, Paula Marshall anticipated what happened in 2019 when Barbados signed agreements with Ghana, West Africa, establishing more African diasporic communication relationships via flight, actual flying airplanes, as opposed to flying back imaginatively, right? With the express purpose then of opening up more direct transportation communication. According to the report, the agreement will help to facilitate the expansion of trade between the two countries in terms of trade transiting through Barbados from Ghana onwards to other ports, right? And the point about this that is significant, and this is what I meant about Marshall being a creative theoretical then, she had already theorized this possibility in The Chosen Place, The Timeless People, in that quote, where Merle says she was not going to take the normal route to Africa, first flying north, and said she was going to go south to Brazil, where the great arm of the hemisphere reaches out towards the massive shoulder of Africa, right? So for me then, Paula Marshall imagined creatively actual possibilities of circulations in which the continent and the Americas are no longer just distant desires for reconnection, but with actual tangible reach, within actual tangible reach. Even if one never makes the physical journey, the exit strategies are already actualized. So my closing meditation, just as the one I started on the island of Ngor, off of Dakar, traveling by plane on the way from, and this is in Caribbean Spaces, so if you get that book, you will find this. Traveling by plane on the way from Sao Paulo to Natal, I experienced exactly what Paul Marshall described in The Chosen Place, The Timeless People. The navigational symbol for the airplane points almost as if it were heading for Africa. I imagine that if we kept going, we would see ourselves recrossing the Atlantic as many of the dispersed Africans did imaginatively without the actual technology of flight. On the map, that giant shoulder of South Africa reaches towards Africa. Recognizing that one is at the closest point here to the continent as to Europe gives me some sort of creative exhilaration and triggers the imagination further. And as the plane turns leftward towards Natal again, the Caribbean archipelago as well as the continental Caribbean reveal themselves. One sees the possibility then of continuing over to the Caribbean, to the Guyanas, Venezuela, and finally to Trinidad, the first island one encounters and the first island the indigenous people encountered as they left the continent, as one leaves South America. Thus we have then a reversing of the paradigm of North-South dominance and a rereading of the world which allows Caribbean space then to exist in its extensions, in its fluidity, in its diasporas. Caribbean space indeed, the space of connection, the consistent filling in of empty spaces. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Boyce-Davies, for that amazing presentation. Thank you so very much. Dr. Boyce-Davies is going to stay here with us and join us for the Q&A following our next speaker, who I'm honored to introduce, Dr. Maryemma Graham. Founded the Project on the History of Black Writing in 1983. It is the longest running documentary and literary archival recovery project focusing on collaborative research, scholarship, and digital humanities. She has published 12 books in the US and internationally, including Mobile and Entangled Americas. I will not mangle the French title, so I will say it in English. Beyond the Ordinary Visible, Essays on Toni Morrison, and the Cambridge History of African American Literature. Graham's biography, The House Where My Soul Lives, The Life of Margaret Walker, is forthcoming from Oxford University Press. So at this time, we're going to look at a short video to sort of preempt Dr. Graham's presentation on John A. Williams. So we'll take a look at that video now.
I think that Johnny Williams is a very versatile writer, screenwriter, novelist, poet, for which he received the American Book Award, just an all-around journalist, all-around writer, does everything.
A. Williams was born in Jackson, Mississippi on December 5, 1925. The first of four children, Williams moved with his parents to Syracuse, New York when he was just 6 months old. A sports fan, Williams played on his high school basketball team before leaving in 1943 to enlist in the United States Navy and serve in World War II. After Williams returned home, he would finish high school and graduate from Syracuse University in 1950, where he earned a Bachelor's of Arts in English and Journalism.
Williams also taught at a number of colleges and universities, including Boston University, the University of Hawaii, LaGuardia Community College, City University of New York, UC Santa Barbara, and Rutgers University, where he held the position of Paul Robeson Professor of English until his retirement in 1994.
As a journalist, Williams published extensively in the mainstream and alternative presses, including Ebony, Jet, Newsweek, the Pittsburgh Courier, and Holiday. Between 1960 and 1999, Williams published 12 full-length novels. '67's The Man Who Cried I Am and 1982's Click song were two of Williams' best known and most critically appreciated work.
I think probably his most important book, in my opinion, is The Man Who Cried I Am. And it's all about the government persecution of black writers when, you know, those days when black writers were really dangerous and not this post-race stuff that they're handed down that's getting all the prizes and everything. It's about the persecution of Langston Hughes, Richard Wright, and some others. And some historical figures are in the book, like Martin Luther King and Malcolm X, who's called, I believe, Minister Q. I think another important book is Click Song, which is about New York literary politics. Two of his books about New York literary politics, The Angry Ones, his first novel, and Click Song, which is about how writers are going to be judged by book scan, you know.
Many of Williams's novels deal with the difficulties of navigating racist social systems as an African American. His work is particularly influenced by his time in the US military as a Navy seaman during World War II. His novels share histories that have been erased or covered over, like those of the abuse faced by African-American servicemen and women. He told the University of Rochester that the closest I came to being killed during the war, when arms were raised specifically against me, was when Americans, sailors, placed a 45 to my head and almost pulled the trigger. No Japanese bomber pilot rifleman or machine gunner ever did that. In novels like Captain Black Man, Williams explores the history of Black combat veterans, writing their heroism back into historical record while never romanticizing the brutality and dehumanization of war.
He went on to write very controversial books like Captain Black Man. Black men participated in World War II. There were racists in the Pentagon who referred to them as cowards and weak and all that. Actually, it was Tuskegee Air Force which first reached the Rhine and escorted B-52s. As a matter of fact, the white pilots of the B-52s first were suspicious of their being their escorts. Then they welcomed them. They said, well, you know, we And the last interview I had with him was in connection with my new book, The Complete Muhammad Ali, and in which I, you know, interviewed people like Harry Belafonte, who was served in World War II, and Johnny Williams. And Johnny Williams told me, I don't think this is public, that Elijah Muhammad was right to obtain conscientious objection status in World War II, which is called the Great War.
Williams has been called arguably the finest Afro-American novelist of his generation, and his two American Book Awards, membership in the National Institute of Arts and Letters, 1977 National Endowment for the Arts Grant, and Phyllis Wheatley Award for invaluable contributions to African-American letters and culture, all speak to his talents as a writer. However, his determination to speak truth to power has sometimes kept him from the critical and popular recognition his work merits.
Johnny Williams, being a journalist and having been a member of the Navy, lends a perspective that we don't get in this sort of like feature for the greatest generation. He and John O. Killens show that while the greatest generation was fighting fascism abroad, they were practicing it at home. Practicing racism at home. And the irony is, for example, that German prisoners in the South were treated better than Black soldiers who were often lynched. So I think that Johnny Williams is somebody who upsets the apple cart, has the courage, like his friend John Killens, to go there.
In a 1995 interview with his son Dennis for the journal Fork Roads, Williams proclaimed that writing was, for him, a question of doing something that I thought I might possibly be able to do in order to maintain sanity. In a world which really, given certain situations, doesn't give a shit whether you exist or not, he said, it is very important that you create yourself. And you do that, or at least I think I did, by writing. Today, we celebrate the literary legacy of John A. Williams.
Some reading sections from Clifford's Blues. The first one is Sunday, May 28th, 1933. My name is Clifford Pepperidge, and I am in trouble. I'm an American Negro, and I play piano sometimes. And I'm a vocalist, too. I shouldn't be here, but they didn't pay any attention to me when they brought me. Didn't listen when I was in Berlin, either. I am in protective custody, they call it. They said I'll be out as soon as they finish their investigation. I hope so. God, I hate this place. As soon as I do get out, I'm hauling ass back home. I don't care what it's like. They never did this to me in New York. And until I left Storyville after they closed it down, I managed not to have anything to do with the John Laws. That's what back home was all about.
Mm-hmm.
That was a wonderful presentation. And now please join me in welcoming Dr. Maryemma Graham, who will give her presentation on John A. Williams. Welcome, Dr. Graham.
Good morning, good afternoon. Thank you so much. It is afternoon for me. This has been amazing. This first panel I was able to listen to just hit all the key points. Following Carol is just great. Thank you so much for this amazing opportunity. As you can see, I cheated a little bit. I gave you Ishmael Reed because he was such a generous person in working with a collective project, which is what I thought I would talk about today, because it was really inspired by people like John A. Williams. So I'm delighted to bring greetings from the staff, both past and present, from the Project on the History of Black Writing, HBW as we are mostly known, to the 2021 National Black Writers Conference, Biennial. I'm even more delighted to join so many writers and scholars that I know and love and whose works I teach, indeed whose lead we continue to follow at HBW. I like to consider our work at Kansas and HBW overall as complementary to the work of the Center for Black Literature. We too share a commitment to broaden, expand, and enrich public knowledge of Black literature. Our particular focus, as you might deduce from the video you've just seen, is on research and recovery within a laboratory environment. In addition to being research intensive, our work is student-centered. And like CBL, we are public-facing. As we continue to expand our digital imprint by building the largest digital archive of Black fiction, we remain committed to our core goals, collaboration, inclusion and innovation, and professional development. Regarding the latter, this coming July, we will host our 15th NEH-funded professional development event, a summer institute for 25 educators, including graduate students and teaching faculty, on Zora Neale Hurston. And although the three-week institute is limited to the participants, we welcome everyone to join our post-institute webinars that will be held in the fall. Go to hurston.ku.edu for more information. Let me again congratulate Dr. Green, Clarence Reynolds, and the amazing team who are responsible for this important event that sustains and builds upon one of our most important institutional legacies. The video you've just seen represents the kind of work that we do at HBW, which has now been in existence for more than 35 years. Specifically, this is the second of our GEMS project, short for Literary Gems. GEMS was born as a video series that would give us opportunities to highlight important writers whom we wanted to, one, introduce to teachers and students in a classroom setting, and two, demystify scholarly and archival practices to encourage more people to take up the work. We like to think that this project on Williams does exactly that. Since we are by and large a project of recovering and tracking Black writing, especially fiction, it was necessary in the 21st century to shift our focus on still living writers, foreparents, as I heard them called earlier, who had received too little critical attention or who had fallen somehow off the radar. With regard to Williams, I'm sure many of you will recall the New York Times obit written by William Grimes with the subtitle, Underrated Novelist who wrote About Black Identity. After an overview of Williams' major published work and career, with a focus on The Man Who Cried I Am and The King God Didn't Save, Grimes concludes the article that casts Williams as the angry Black man. The final paragraph reads, over time, some of the fire abated. I'm still angry, he's quoting Williams, but can't just be angry all the time, Mr. Williams told Publishers Weekly in 1976, but his reputation as a supremely talented but undervalued writer remained unchanged. We believe at HBW that if we create collaborative opportunities for students to design, research, and produce finished products, we can help feed more scholarship, especially on these writers. The John A. Williams Gems was completed in 2015, before John left us. Our intention with Gems had always been to interview these selected writers, get the story from the horse's mouth, so to speak, and do a deep dive into their archives. After our success with Mari Evans, which we were able to premiere with her present at a Four Seas conference in Indianapolis, we began working on John A. Williams in late 2013. When I reached out to Dennis, I knew that time was not on our side. Moreover, the process was protracted since Rochester was very protective of his papers, and rightly so. With the family's help, we finally succeeded in getting the footage we wanted, but the process took a full year. Since with Williams himself, we settled on giving more camera time to Ishmael Reed, who had agreed already to be our talking head. As you've seen, the 2015 video will need to be adjusted and remastered for viewing in other formats, but it serves a purpose as an introduction to John A. Williams, to students, by a group of students who produced it themselves. Meredith Wiggins and Kenton Ramsey, the lead of the team that included undergrad and other grad students working with them. So GEMS, we can consider an intergenerational, interdisciplinary media dialogue with various entities, including scholars, archivists, videographers. Thus, it is a teaching learning tool that jumpstarts a new conversation. There are currently 3 videos in the series, 2 of whom we were fortunately able to complete with the active participation of the subjects, although they have now left us, Mari Evans and Naomi Long Magic. By way of background, let me say that I first met John A. Williams vicariously through his son, Dennis. But Williams was a constant presence since my graduate study was focused on mapping the landscape of writers, especially in the 20th century. Truth be told, I was a product of a particular generation. I still am. You wrote about dead writers, but you could and should read all Black writers. Saunders Redding was the advisor who clung to that view. But his conservatism served me well, since he had done a brief stint at the National Endowment for the Humanities, which he pushed me to include as part of my future work. But more importantly, he knew everybody and willingly gave me personal access to the individuals who could provide me with what I call my larger education, along with the access to their private libraries. Thus, I had the Schomburg on weekends, but I also spent time with people like Clarence Holt before his collection entered the Schomburg. That one visit to his library turned me into a permanent bibliophile. Williams was among the 4 accessible, and I stress the word accessible here, writers who had currency during my years in graduate school. I had encountered and begun my long journey with Margaret Walker, and it was perhaps my discussions with Walker and Saunders Redding together who encouraged me to pay close attention to John A. Williams, Ishmael Reed, John O. Killens, and Ernest Gaines, who represented a generation after Wright and were part of what Williams himself called the Second Renaissance. Invisible Man by Ralph Ellison qualified for study, but my tendency was to take the road less traveled. Since the writers above were publishing as I pursued my education, if you were in Black literature at the time, you put your name on the wait list at the library immediately, scrambling for reviews wherever you found them, sometimes in the New York Times Book Review, or Review of Books, I guess it's called. Discussions of Black women writers were brokered by the distance between upstate New York, where I was, and New York City and the East Coast more generally. But conversations with the late Roseanne Pope Bell and Betty Parker Smith, 2 of the editors for Sturdy Black Bridges, made sure I was aware of the monumental work of Mary Helen Washington, who joins us today, especially her first volume, Black Eyed Susan, which helped me to complete that larger education. Reflecting back on those times, although Paul Marshall did not publish a book between 1969 and 1983, for as you have heard, her work was allowed to go out of print, The visit of George Lamming at Cornell provided a healthy introduction to Caribbean literature, including my first visit with Paul Marshall and Louise Merriweather, who is still with us and who is the subject of our next gems. Since my arrival at Kansas, Marshall made two visits. The first for the centennial of Langston Hughes in 2002, where I can still remember the wonderful story of her visit to Paris with Langston Hughes as his special guest, and the visits, night visits by Hughes, but then the disappearance into the Paris environment before morning. Fast forward to the life of HBW since our arrival at Kansas in 1999. By the time we settled in, we had been curating, though the term was as yet common parlance, which meant we were collecting, preserving, interviewing writers, and presenting Black writing for 15 years in ways very public. While the bibliophile side appealed to me personally, I was also well aware that I'd spent so much of my graduate school years on that late night bus between Ithaca and New York City for weekends at the Schomburg. Collections were basically not accessible otherwise. As our collection grew, we, like the Center for Black Literature, realized the need to become more intentional in our work. We had a growing collection, a database, and continued to secure support from NEH for our summer institutes. But there was a critical missing component. It was this missing component that our grad students brought to us. We quickly grabbed what I consider the best and the brightest who entered KU with skills, vision, interest, and commitment to doing a new kind of work that was technologically driven. They were inspiring and inspired because, one, we had so much stuff, and two, they could carve out new career pathways that could have made greater impact than we had had so far. I remain grateful for the team that persisted in completing the Williams Gems video and HBW's ongoing work. So I ask and want to share with you the lessons that I think we learned from John A. Williams. It has generally been understood that the enormous success of The Man Who Cried I Am and the subsequent publication of his 12 novels, 6 works of nonfiction, a volume of poetry, constitutes far more than a successful career. It does make Williams, as Reed and James L. LeJong and others have both suggested, the finest African-American novelist of his generation. It has also been suggested that that career was derailed by the negative reaction to the King God Didn't Save. Writing at a time when King was seen as an American icon with no allowance for his humanity, icons of course are not human, Williams likely did not expect the reaction he received. The investigative journalist in him was an impulse that he could not resist. And it raises important questions about how we pigeonhole writers who step outside of what is perceived as their lane unless they have the appropriate validation to do so. I like to spend the remainder of my time, however, sharing what I think is really the gift that, along with an expansive body of creative work, Williams left us. In 2008, Williams and his wife, Lori, published Dear Chester, Dear John, the 25-year correspondence between Chester Himes and John A. Williams. This is a genre that is invaluable as literary and social history, and one that I wish to encourage us to give greater attention to. The complexities of literary friendships over time is more than what passes between two friends, and it's more than the networks of which they are part, but it provides us with another level of experiential and perceptual knowledge about the times in which these writers lived and the changing tastes of the literary market. In the case of Dear Chester, Dear John, we hear Williams' side of that excruciatingly painful experience of first being recommended for the prestigious Prix de Rome by a jury of American writers only to be rejected by the head of the Praetorome himself, who used as his reason that John A. Williams did not compare to the likes of Ralph Ellison or William Styron. Such judgments and stories are legion. For example, I discovered just as I was about to wrap up the manuscript for the biography of Margaret Walker that she was in fact nominated for a Pulitzer Prize for My People in 1943. But the committee chose instead to give Robert Frost his fourth Pulitzer that year. It was not until 7 years later in 1950 that Gwendolyn Brooks was the first African-American author to win a Pulitzer Prize. I'm sure that many of you out there are thinking that it might have made a difference in Walker's life had she known that before she died. That such deliberations and the workings of social networks might be revealed in letters makes them an invaluable resource. This in its most intimate form. Such a legacy represents an opportunity of a lifetime, one that cannot be overstated. Dear John, dear Chester, dear John is somewhat of an anomaly, since most of what we know is from the New Negro Renaissance period. For example, Charles Nichols, Arnabone Thompson, Langston Hughes' letters published in 1990, Emily Bernard's Remembering Me to Harlem, the letters between Langston Hughes and Carl Van Vechten, 2001, and Carla Kaplan's Hurston, A Life in Letters in 2002. I recognize that publications of this sort have a great deal to do with whether or not the cultural capital exists so that one, a project can have an audience, and two, a publisher can be found or secured. But just as diaries of frontier and pioneer women in particular, have made what was invisible more visible, produced by women who are unknown to us before we read them, I think we have a responsibility to create the discursive threshold that such a genre needs to survive and be supported. In the introduction to Kaplan's Hurston, A Life in Letters, the late Robert Hemingway credits all of Hurston's correspondents as her true and faithful critics, for they recognized her genius and kept her letters, convinced that Zora's fame would one day rise to the necessity of such a volume. We are living in the era of the archive, but the archive is also changing. And as the earlier panel indicated, there are new opportunities, both technologically and through networking, to create hybrid models for publishing, producing, writing, and scholarship. John A. Williams' example was his last book. With that last book is one that we can certainly follow. The Project on the History of Black Writing was not able to allow John Williams to speak for himself when we were working on the Gems video. The need to make more materials accessible is greater now than ever before. We must complement these kinds of public events with as much information from and about these writers as possible. With a book like Dear Chester, Dear John, we have one such model for collective work that we can be very intentional about. We must also consider that the era of letter writing is one that we are quickly leaving behind. Thus, this may be our last opportunity to protect our writers and provide opportunities for understanding the worlds in which they lived through their firsthand knowledge. In closing, the Center for the Study of Black Literature has given us this platform for meeting and championing our writers. It has made them accessible to us. John A. Williams and Paul Marshall, I am sure that they would agree with me that we too have our own work to do. There are enough scholars, graduate students, journalists, writers, who along with media professionals in general among us to will more projects into being and to complete them. And I can assure you, if you want to challenge conventional readings and canons, as the panel talked about earlier, there's no better way than to do that than to work more intergenerationally and create bridges across perceived boundaries. As we continue to give John A. Williams the critical attention he so deserves, I do not want us to discount the importance of his last book for pointing out a critical lacuna that we need to fill. Let me note here that the volume, Dear Chester, Dear John, also outlines the unfinished projects that John had left behind, because he was communicating with his friend about those projects. The most important of one of those, I think, was his plan to do a nonfiction studies on several Black writers. And while he went in another direction, he and his son Dennis did finish the volume, as you know, on Richard Pryor. But the plan for the project is there. I think the quote that you all know is most fitting, is the most fitting closing for my comments here. We die. That may be the meaning of life, but we do language. Toni Morrison. John A. Williams' survival depends upon our ability to bring him from the background, from the shadows, to the foreground and into the light, to study his words and to represent them in new ways. He starts us by what he left us. It is our job to take up the work in the 21st century contexts. We honor him by following his lead as a multiply talented novelist, journalist, critic, and yes, correspondent. I'm looking forward to your questions and thank you very much.
Thank you so very much, Dr. Graham. That was wonderful. We are going to open the conversation to everyone who is in attendance today. If you do have a question, you can post it in the Q&A that you will find at the bottom of the screen. But I want to kind of start us off because I have questions. and if you could just, this is for both of you. If you could just talk to us, I know that each of you touched on, you know, your scholarship and things like that and the stuff that you're doing, but how and why did you come to develop your scholarship around the specific writer that you spoke about today? Why them as opposed to someone else? Because I know you didn't just wake up one day and say, oh, Dr. Green wants us to do a presentation on unsung heroes and let me find somebody. Why them? Dr. Boyce-Davies, can we start with you and then we'll go directly to Dr. Graham.
Sure, thank you for that great question. Actually, I did not thank for, if you don't mind, I need to thank Brenda Green for and the center for just staying the course, because I mean I've been there at events before, but to actually maintain the years of these presentations and to keep it always at such a great level, I want to reach out and say, you know, big thanks and big up to Dr. Brenda Green and her staff and to all of you for doing this. Why Marshall? Well, this is a shameless plug, okay? But but today we are doing this evening, later after all of this is over, we are doing the 30th anniversary of Out of the Kumbla, Caribbean Women in Literature. So in my case, I'm a Howard graduate, studied African studies at HU with really amazing people. Now that I look back, you know, you kind of take people for granted before, but now that I look back, on my campus then was Sterling Brown, Arthur P. Davis, I did African American Lit with, Stephen Henderson, Ethelbert Miller worked upstairs in African American Studies Library. Stephen Henderson was on my thesis committee. Leon Damas, founder of Negritude, one of the founders, was one of my thesis, was my thesis advisor. And I have amazing stories about Damas and how lovely a kind man he was. So anyway, I didn't take classes with CLR James, but I sat in class with people when there was a major speaker like Sylvia Winter showing up. So in other words, I'm saying that my formation coming from the Caribbean, I've lived the diaspora to universities in the United States, studying with the amazing Mary Fair Burks at University of Maryland Eastern Shore, who I discovered later was an activist who worked in civil rights organizing in Alabama, Paula Giddings references her. Then she was just the prof and really difficult prof as well that everybody was terrified of. I aced her work always. But essentially my formation is diasporic and therefore Marshall totally is somebody who is one of the best exponents of that. So in Alto de Cumbla, as I suggested 30 years ago, published in 1990, I wrote a paper about gender and heritage in the work of Caribbean women writers. Because as you know, most of us who came through the university, as lovely as those scholars were, they were not looking at women. They were not necessarily, it wasn't that they didn't see them as important. I remember when I did Arthur P. Davis's class, all he said about Zaudine Hurston was that she was interesting and controversial. And he was amazing, scopic, knew everything about everybody. So basically women were not figuring. So when my generation came in the midst of Black women's writing, and I'm so glad Maryemma used that Toni Morrison quote at the end, it's so amazing. For me then, as a Caribbean subject, where do I put myself in terms of understanding this? And then how do I also question Caribbean and African literature that I was studying? And that's precisely what I did. So Paula Marshall then, such a lovely, amazing human being as well, who also kept telling me her name is Paul, not Paula. So she would always say, no, it's Paul. So anyway, she was always a joy to engage, and I invited her to Binghamton when I was a prof there, and we invited her to Miami as well towards the end of her years. So, and I've met her so many. She would come to African Literature Association conferences and sit and listen to what the scholars were saying about her. People would be intimidated, but she didn't care. Just wanted to know what we were thinking about her work. So this is, we are beneficiaries of a delightful group of scholars who preceded us, and we can only represent and take their work further. That's all I'm doing.
Thank you so much. And Dr. Graham.
Yeah, I have to add to what Carol has said, because I think the network within which we were trained, that the generation that passed on to us won an intensity for doing this kind of work because we watched them do it. But what I would add was that a kind of resistance to some of their thinking. And that is what, I mean, I would tell people this story that when Saunders Redding had Alzheimer's at the end of his life, his wife called me and said, I think the only thing that could bring him back is for you to have one more fight with him. And so I visited him in the summer, and literally we've continued to fight as if I was still his grad student, and he was just agreeing and disagreeing with me. Because it was always, I'd come in and sit down and I say, but look at all these writers. And he said, no, you can't work on them. So I couldn't work on these writers for my dissertation. But he kept giving me access to writers that were writing and kept saying, you gotta read them, but you can't write about them. Dissertations write about dead people. He didn't say that, but he meant that. And he did mean it. But so on the one hand, you sort of have this mantle placed over you with the when a generation of people you're working with and who are training you and who you know are imparting to you a certain kind of wisdom and who are basically expecting you to do a lot more work. But you also have to have, at least in my case, to fight with them about certain kinds of narrowness and oversights and the kinds of absences and gaps in their own thinking. And so I'm stuck at, you know, Cornell. The only person that helped to open that up was a George Lamming for Caribbean literature. And Lamming actually took me to visit Paul Marshall and, like I said, Louise Merriweather, who is 98 and still living, as we know. So I got to think about writers who were with us living and working, but they weren't the people that I got to tell a story about in my acceptable dissertation. So I think that the work after that was driven by, okay, I did what I had to do, and now I got to do what I want to do. And so HBW was really born as I was a grad student thinking about, you know, you made me do this, but I really think that we need to be doing something else. And as I said, whenever you say do something else, any graduate student would give you a list of things that they tell you that they think we should be doing. And so I've been inspired by the fact that they have constantly brought new ideas to the table and new approaches to things. And of course they add all the technology that we didn't have access to. The other thing is that had I not been what I am now, I would have been a librarian. And because the library was my babysitter when I was growing up. It was across the street from my school. My parents worked, and the requirement to keep from getting in trouble was to go to the library after school, and I would be picked up from the library. And my parents knew me well enough to know that you don't come and pick me up at the same time, because I could be doing something and then get to the library in time to be picked up so that you would know what I'd be doing. So they would show up at different times. So I had to stay in the library. Well, if you're in the library, what are you gonna do? You're gonna read. But it turned out I loved reading and finished the children's books. And it was a segregated Black library in the South. And at that time, Black librarians had a certain kind of freedom. I'm from Augusta, Georgia. And so we had one major Black branch library, and that library had all of Frank Yerby's books. Frank Yerby at the time was not a canonical writer. Nobody was writing about him. He was a popular writer. He was outside a model for my community. And writing was something that people would thought was a good thing to do. So this notion of living in an environment with books, recognizing writing is something important, and then writers that we just didn't have access to or who were dismissed or not talked about was something that I felt I could do, even though I wasn't a librarian. I took another path, but that librarian, that archivist was still in me. And so this is a way I get to do both of those things and bring writers back in ways I think that we really need to. I mean, I'm very serious about my last comments about the letters of writers. We don't have letter writing now as we used to. And if we let this get away from us, we're gonna miss so much information about the lives and the work and the interconnections, across connections, across fertilization of writers between all parts of the diaspora, but certainly Europe, the Caribbean, the US, Africa. Writers were communicating with each other. We know that tradition was alive and well. And so the best way for me to keep that connection is to really look at the body of their work. And for me, those original kinds of works like letters and manuscripts, as Mary Helen talks about, the unwritten, unpublished work by Paul Marshall, all that is really invaluable. But that's the archivist in me speaking. And I admit that my passion is there. And I try to pass that passion on to others. But I think those are the reasons that sort of pushed me to think about writers like John A. Williams, because for 12 books, for God's sake, 12 novels alone, and yet not to have the attention that he deserved. So I think we got to think about these Renaissance in these writers, the revival of these writers, so that they become much more familiar to us in different formats, we can present them in different ways. I know we've got a performance coming after this. So I think that this way of rethinking how we communicate with various publics is really important. And this is the time to do that.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you so much for that. There's a couple questions in the Q&A. One ties back to what you were talking about just now, Dr. Graham, and I'd like to pose this question actually to both of you. When we talk about letters and the communication between writers and that history that those letters hold for us, there's only a handful, that we know of that's been done. If you all had your dithers, who would you like to see letters between? That's one of the questions that's being asked.
Oh my goodness.
What writers would you like to see letters between?
Yes. I'll start out, but this is interesting. I finished the Margaret Walker biography, and this woman was writing letters and journals. I mean, the journals are another area too. There's so much stuff there, writing everybody, because that was the letter writing was the form, the choice of communication that people had. And small notes, writers writing to each other, congratulating a writer on the publication of a book, just a brief note. Or as everybody knows, Langston Hughes's green ink, writing in green ink. And everybody who has those letters you know, from Hughes would want to save them. Hurston's style of critique is in those letters. So I think it's important that we do that. So I would love to see the communication between Black women writers in those early years as they were talking to one another about the difficulties of getting published, trying to encourage each other to do this or do that. I'd like to know how Paul Marshall, and I'm sure Mary Helen will talk a little bit more about this, Paul Marshall communicated with writers because she always wanted to be a writer. Who was she talking to? We know she talked to Langston. The story about Langston, you know, she talked about Langston. She wouldn't let us publish that piece. I wanted to, but she wouldn't let us because she said she was going to do it herself. This memory of Langston Hughes in Paris. But the experience of writing back from being in Paris, being out of the country, writing family, writing other writers, because people, I'd like to know how Black women writers over those earlier years wrote to with one another. I would love to get the feedback from sort of the male canon. You know, we have that male canon in that period, particularly in the 70s and 80s. There's a tremendous critique, and I don't want to, you know, push Ishmarine on this question, but this critique of Black women writers that transpired, I'd like to see some of those internal communications. We have a lot of public stuff, but I want to know what people said behind the scenes to each other. Writers, male writers writing to each other. There's an unusual opportunity, I think, for a cross-generational dialogue. I think in 2021, we will see the letters and the diaries of Alice Walker by Valerie Boyd. That will be published. So we are beginning, I think, to pay attention to more of these kinds of manuscript personal writings. So I think after we see Alice Walker, we'll probably be getting publishers wanting us to say, do you have any more? Is there something else we should be doing? So I think we're about to turn the corner on that, but I don't want us to just do, quote, canonical writers. I want us to do early writing. I want us to be the period of struggle before people became famous. What was it like? Because the biggest difference, I think, has been the literary establishment, the shifts, the awarding of single, you know, top writers, writers who are known, writers who are published at the expense of others. I'm sure people are talking a lot about that. So my first choices would be Black women writing to each other. It would be writers earlier in their lives as they began to communicate, reaching out to writers, asking for advice. And then I'd like to know the generation, you know, who's still with us. I mean, are they leaving their letters somewhere so we can do this? I guess that's the other appeal I would make. Carol, what are you thinking about that?
Thank you. Thank you so much. Yes, yes. Would you please add a little bit? And then I have one more question before we end, because this has gone by again, like so incredibly quickly. So if you could ask.
Well, I don't have a lot to say. Maryemma, you held that down really, really well. I'm thinking though, for the more, well, first of all, I want to say that in some cases, a lot of those letters are not, did not make it, particularly the ones from Africa and the Caribbean, for all kinds of reasons, including family not seeing them as valuable and so on. So that's something that I think for the Caribbean and African literatures, that one will have to really insist on finding ways to do this, do what you're doing, Maryemma. But I wanted to go back a little bit further to say that when I was at Howard, I actually worked in the library. So we have, yeah, I worked in the Founders Library, right down to I didn't really do a lot of work because people were so lovely. I was working on my thesis, so they kind of let me pass. But it was down the hall from Moreland. So I would just always like take time and run to Moreland and find something, run back and so on, where Dorothy Porter was there. And throughout my undergraduate life, librarians were, and libraries were also so critical. So I like your point about bringing these two together in our thinking and our work. I should say, one of my students, Marcia Douglas, who is a writer, she's created a kind of imaginative view of if she would have found Zora Neale Hurston's camera that she lost when she was on her travels, what would it have inside of it? So she's actually writing, she's recreating that as an imaginative piece. And I was thinking, I'm not sure if in the Carly Kaplan series of letters, which I haven't looked at for a while, if she wrote from Haiti, what kinds of things did she say? I need to go back and look at that now to see the connections. But the other thing I think that we found out just from doing work on Frederick Douglass recently is how he was so cued into Haiti. Of course, he was an ambassador to Haiti, but also wrote about West Indian emancipation. So the question of the diasporic global connections, it seems, we sometimes lose when we just have only one domestic view. But just to round off your question, Donna, I'm thinking for the next generation or the contemporary generation of writers, a lot of that is probably taking place, Maryemma, on internet, not so? So somebody is going to have to keep those and archive those. Exactly. Because I think that's probably one of the things that we need to not let pass, that this is happening now, but there's a lot going on because it's online, and especially in this time of lockdown and so on, pandemic time.
Yeah. Yes, absolutely. The whole new body of work of writers, if you think about the whole digital space, what that looks like, the communications between writers on Twitter, on Instagram Live, Facebook. So all of these are forms of communication, between writers and their readers. And, to archive that type of work would probably be quite illuminating, to say the very least. We are basically kind of like sort of out of time, and I'm so very upset. I just really have one question, and I want you both to answer this as quickly as you can. In the moment when you had the opportunity to be engaged with John Williams and Paul Marshall, did you have any concept of the power that you were in the midst of during that time? Or was it, he's a good writer, he's interesting. Did you realize just how influential and important they actually were in that moment? Yes or no?
I would say I did. I was always in awe of them. But I remember once my kids were little then, and I was inviting Marshall to Binghamton, and I had called her. And then she called me back, and my daughter, who was like a little girl then, 4 or 5, she loved to pick up the phone, and she'd be talking to a person. She was actually talking to Paul Marshall. And I was like, who are you talking to on the phone? She said, oh, somebody named Paul Marshall. I was like, what? Give me that phone. So essentially, I was more in awe. And here these people were so amazingly delightful that she would reach a young kid on the phone and engage her in conversation and spend a lot of time. So it's, they're both, right? They were such luminous figures, so lovely as people, human beings, but at the same time, so creative and so powerful. And that's what I want to say about them.
What about you, Dr. Grant, really quickly?
I agree. I mean, I was terrified because, these are big figures. You didn't, and I think my experience was probably because I did an interview with Frank Yerby, and again, I had grown up with him. He lived in Spain, and everybody always Spain. And it took me forever to get an interview with him. So the idea of how difficult it was to get to a writer was always in my head. But yet, when I would meet them, they would be just everyday, ordinary people. Mm-hmm. Or, eating something that I never thought they would be eating. Or just being very normal. But that thought of it was terrifying. And but of course, again, you think about the new technology, people are writing and Facebook and people have websites, communicate with writers now in a very different way. And even though the writers may not be communicating, they may have an agent or, you know, or an assistant doing it. The fact is they seem to have more access. We did not think about having access like that, unless you were working on them or you had an opportunity. And you, of course, and my mother, you talk about your children. My kids did that as well. But it was my mother who would say, now you're gonna go and do, and she said, remind your manners, know what you're supposed to do. Because she would say, she would scare the heebie-jeebies out of me by saying, you know, you're representing the race, you're doing all this stuff. You know, that was what I got. Again, Southern tradition, older Black women saying, you have a chance, you're speaking for the rest of us, blah, 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 blah. So it terrified you.
Yeah. Thank you both so, so very much. I could talk with you both forever. And I know our audience would just love to continue listening to you. But